the year 1857. We know it as the year of the Indian Mutiny. That year, the Britishers felt, first time in the British India, they felt threatened that the Indians could also revolt. And Queen Victoria was very worried. She sent her spies to India to investigate and find out who are these influential people in the society who have managed to revolt against the Britishers. And they identified two such. So these two communities were identified. One was the female sex workers, we call them prostitutes. And the second category were the transgenders, specifically the hijras. Now these two communities were financially powerful because they had a lot of money. And they were also socially very influential because a lot of Indians and, I mean, the whole population visits them. They are very powerful in many ways. So she decided there should be some law should be enacted so that she could crush the power of these two communities. And that's how they will be able to have better control on India, British India, so that Indians do not revolt. So under Lord Macaulay, they enacted a law in India, which is called Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code. This law says that whosoever voluntarily has carnal intercourse against the order of nature with a man, woman, or animal, which involves penetration but doesn't result in procreation, shall be subject to 10 years imprisonment and or fine, with fine, or sometimes even life imprisonment. So this law came into existence in 1860. Now, India, as we all know, got independent in 1947, but we got rid of the Britishers, of course, but we still continued with the laws which were framed by the Britishers. There was no question of having any revolt or anything, but still, anyway, that law was carried forward. The interesting thing is that most of us think that this law is only an anti-sodomy law, anti-something to do with the homosexual population, but no. If you look at the legal interpretation of this law, it says that anyone having sexual intercourse against the order of nature, which is penetrative but not resulting in procreation, which means that even a married man and a woman, if they are indulging in any kind of sexual activity, it could be oral sex, it could be anal sex, it could be vaginal sex, without procreation, she could be infertile, she could be in her menopause, she could have used, the man could have used a condom. So that means you can only have sex with the result of procreation in order not to violate this law. So, I'm coming to another stage. Another legal interpretation is also saying that even masturbation is falling into that category. So now you see, I think the whole audience in this hall is, we are all criminals. So we should have more jails. The whole country is a criminal. And still we are managing with this law. But this law had to kind of go, because we cannot have such laws. I mean, not just this law, you'd be surprised, there are some 150 redundant laws in our country which are still being carried on by us, even though the Britishers are no longer ruling us. Just to give you a small example, I was just reading the other day, there is a law which says that if an RTO officer comes to office without polishing his shoes, he can be suspended. And this law is still there in India. And tell me how many even officers are wearing shoes, you know. I mean, that is a British culture. We wear chappals, sandals, sometimes officer might come barefoot also. So similarly, Section 377 is an archaic British colonial law made by Queen Victoria for addressing the revolt. And why it has come to our country, I don't understand. When we say our India, we say India is, of course, I'm proud to be Indian. I'm proud to be to have this rich cultural heritage. But at the same time, India is a total country of paradox. On one hand, we are proud about India, its culture. It's a land of the Kama Sutra, which was dating back to 2,500 years. We have temples of Khajuraho and things like that. And still, we are saying homosexuality was not an Indian culture. It was a Western influence. Sorry, friends, I don't agree with that. It was not a Western influence. We had exported homosexuality. Otherwise, where are these temples and where has this Kama Sutra just suddenly appeared from? Anyway, so the first case which was filed was by an organization called the NAS Foundation. They filed this in the Delhi High Court. This case was filed. And fortunately, in 2009, this case was, the judgment came in our favor. And all we were asking was for that if the two adults, they are the two partners are adults, and they are consenting with each other, then they should not be treated as criminals. And the Delhi High Court approved of that, because another thing which happened was that when India got independent, our Honorable Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar has written one of the most lengthiest constitutions of the world. And this constitution is giving us fundamental rights, are being guaranteed to all citizens equally irrespective of their caste, creed, race, religion, and sexuality. I mean, most of us here would not even have read the constitution. So, you know, there's no question of if one is ignorant about it. But the important thing is that this law is a direct violation of the fundamental rights. Right to equality, for example. Where there is right to equality? I mean, we are always subject to stigma and discrimination. I came out and my mother and father threw me out of the palace. They said, no, you're gay, you cannot stay in the palace. Okay, what have I done wrong? Just to be gay is something wrong, something offensive. So that is happening with each and every person who decides to live a truthful life. But we challenged this law on constitutional grounds, and that's how the Delhi High Court judgment came in our favor. I remember when this law was passed, the law minister was one Mr. Veerappan Moily. It was the Congress government. And Mr. Veerappan Moily made this statement on national television that this is the best argued case in the history of India, because we had all the arguments, we provided with the evidence from all sources. I mean, whether it was mythological or historical, cultural, psychological, physical, mental, all kinds of evidence. And that's how this law was won. This case was won. And Congress accepted its defeat, says we kind of respect the Delhi High Court judgment, and we don't wish to go into appeal. And there was a jubilation amongst the LGBT community. A lot of members of the community, they came out not only just to their parents and families, but even to the media. A lot of parents, some of them, not a lot, some of the parents have also accepted their children. We have case of Chitra Palekar, Amol Palekar's wife, who accepted her daughter. There are several other parents. Parents formed an association called the Straight Gay Alliance, which is similar to the association in America called PFLAG, Parents and Friends of Lesbians and Gays. Now, very interestingly, what happened, that This happened in 2009. Now we were quite hopeful, oh, Congress has accepted defeat. Now we are victorious. But no. The religious leaders of India, for the first time in the history of India, all united together. The Hindus, Muslims, Christians, this, that, I mean, we fight, even within Hindus, we fight. Even within Muslims, there's a fight. But they all decided, no. Now this case, we cannot allow them to happen. So they all came together and they filed an appeal. One of them was our Baba Ramdev. Sorry if there is any follower of him. He said, no, this homosexuality is a mental disorder, it's a disease, and I'm going to cure it. And he even challenged me also. I was on national television with him. And he said, in 3 months, I'm going to make you straight. I said, OK, try it out. If you can't make me straight in three months, you come to Rajpipla, in 3 hours, I'll make you gay. So that's 2009. This is 2018. He has not yet taken up my challenge. I'm still waiting. I'm waiting. Come to Rajpipla. I'm waiting for you, you know. But no, this is hypocrisy. This is what I call hypocrisy. Yes, you are a learned person. I respect you for what you're doing for yoga, what you're doing under Patanjali. It's very respectable. But one of the things is acceptance of truth. We do not accept truth. See, I accepted truth, I came out. So what happened to me? We all know. I don't have to go much. You can go on my Wikipedia page and see what has happened to me. But yet I have stood with the truth. I said, no, doesn't matter. Truth is truth. If I am wearing a red cap today, I cannot say it is black. You have to accept it. So anyway, 2009, they went into appeal in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court unfortunately took a decision against us. Fortunately, even though the Supreme Court reversed the case, it went back to 150 years, we went back to 1860 again. But the support we got from the society was much more than the support we got when we won the case in Delhi High Court. So it definitely a lot of publicity was generated about the Section 377, and we were fortunate to have a lot of people who even supported us. One of them, as I told you, was this Parents Association who filed a petition in the court. Very interestingly, the Indian Psychiatric Association also filed a petition saying that homosexuality is not a mental disorder. After American Psychiatric Association, of course, in 1970s, they had already ruled it out. Indian Psychiatric Association did that. Bollywood supported us very greatly. And just recently, just 2 days back, I read in the newspaper, this Keshav Suri from the Lalit Hotels, he has filed a petition now in the Supreme Court. So now the situation is that there is a curative petition which has been filed in the Supreme Court, which is going to be heard anytime. Very good thing which happened was that the curative petition was allowed. It was admitted. There are only 4 such cases since independence which have been allowed by the Supreme Court, because Supreme Court is the highest authority. You cannot go beyond that. But in very rare cases where it is found that certain grounds have been violated while giving the judgment, then you can file a curative petition. So it was admitted. A 3-member judge bench has been appointed to listen to our case. Another thing, good thing which Supreme Court has done is that this case is not to be heard in a closed judge chamber. It's going to be heard in open court. This case will be reopened because they have found that the previous Supreme Court judgment was not justified. So that's one thing which is good has happened. Then a number of things which have happened since 2000, this happened in 2013, and now finally we got the news that Supreme Court is taking up this matter. Very soon it's going to come up, maybe in a month or 2 months' time, we don't know. But since 2014 to 2018, a lot of things have happened which have come in our favor. So the first thing which came in our favor was the NALSA judgment, which gave where the Supreme Court has given the transgender the rights. That came in 2014, in April 2014. And yes, just yesterday on dinner, I was sharing with the friends from this university that we are also in the process of forming the The first transgender welfare board in Gujarat, this just happened 2 days back. The government has already made the announcement. So out of the LGBT, at least now we can, T are assured, you know. So now we have to fight for the rest of the L, G, and B. That was one thing good. The second good thing which happened was that in 2015, if I'm not mistaken, the health ministry under the Ministry of Health and Family Affairs, Government of India, brought out this app. This app is it's a health app, and it's targeting the youth population of India. And mind you, I think you know the youth population is the largest in the world, Indian youth population. And this app is saying that it's okay for a man to be attracted towards another man, and it's also okay for another woman to be attracted towards another woman. So this is health ministry has brought this. So that's again another good sign. And let me correct, again bring you back to the older judgment that even though there was the government, there was a kind of accepted the defeat and all, but there was within the government also there was a conflict. So the health ministry had also filed a petition in the court saying that HIV, I also work for HIV AIDS, section 377 is an impediment to HIV control in India. And mind you, we are the third highest in the world with regards to HIV infections. The official figures are saying that 2.5 million people are already infected with HIV. So it's not a small number. So the NACO, that's the National AIDS Control Association, has filed a petition. So that's how the health ministry is in our favor. So the health app was done. A very significant thing which happened just last year was by Justice Chandrachud of the Supreme Court, who has given us the right to privacy. So that was another thing which we were fighting for. Right to privacy is a very important right under the fundamental rights, which was violated by Section 377. What we are doing in the bedroom with the closed walls of the room, with consent of each other, and if you're adults, what is the government to do with that? You might masturbate, you might have oral sex, you might have anal sex, you might have any kind of sex. That how can the government decide what kind of sex you're having? That is absolutely a violation of right to privacy. So this right to privacy has definitely paved a way for us. And now, very shortly, this case will be heard, fingers crossed, after the Aadhaar card thing. Now this is the next thing which is going to be decided. But I want to tell you another thing, that this law has been misused more than it has been used. And I'll give you an example. This happened in front of my eyes. My organization, that's the Lakshya Trust, which works in Gujarat for HIV AIDS. Now, before I tell you the story, I want to bring you to another paradox situation in India. So India, we call it a country of paradox, as I told you before. When on one hand, we have the law, Section 377, which is criminalizing the homosexual act. On the other hand, we have a government. And when I talk about government, I'm giving example of government of Gujarat. Government of Gujarat has been funding my organization, the Lakshya Trust, since the year 2000, that's 18 years, funding and supporting it. And I signed a contract with the health ministry, which says that we are supposed to be working for HIV prevention and awareness amongst men having sex with men. So what does it mean? So one Canadian journalist asked me, oh, so the government is supporting you also in funding? I said, yeah, this is happening in India. It's 18 years I'm getting funding from government, and still they're calling you criminal? I said, yeah. So they're still calling me criminal. So saying, then isn't government also a criminal? I said, well, I have to ask that question to myself, because even abetment to crime can be criminal. So in a way, government is also a criminal, according to if you look at it in that sense. Anyway, so under the contract, we are supposed to be distributing condoms to the field areas. So when my workers went, I'm talking about 2002, now things have changed, 2002, 2003, my workers were distributing condoms at Kamati Bag in Baroda for safe sex advocacy. Suddenly police appears there. what are you doing, what are you doing? This, you cannot do this. You cannot distribute condoms. Ye homogiri chodo, bhag jao yahan se. Don't indulge into all this. You know, they were using all bad words and all. I don't want to use that also now. And then they started extorting money from my workers and telling me, give me your mobile phone. Give me this. Yo, ring nikal ke do. Give me this. Give me that. Otherwise, I'm going to call your mom and dad and tell your son is homo. Your son is gay. That kind of thing they started doing. That was fine. They have gone to the extent of arresting my workers, taking them to jail, that they have violated Section 377. Now, mind you, there is no penetration, there is no procreation. Forget procreation. There is no penetration. They are just distributing condoms. But police has the law enforcing authorities of India are themselves misusing this law and saying that they are violating Section 377. So they arrested my workers. And you know what they did? They had forced sex with my workers without condoms. So you imagine, now who's the criminal? Are my workers the criminal who have been contracted by the government, salaries paid by them, condoms are provided by the government to distribute condoms, and the police is having sex with my workers against their wishes, and that also without condoms, and thereby you are increasing the risk of HIV. So that's why this law needs to go, because there is a lot of misuse, people are hiding, and see, sex is something which nobody does it in open. We all do it in private. And if this is the way, if the people are going, then it's not going to work any, it's not going to go anywhere ahead. Then World Bank has recently done a study, and the World Bank has said that the economic development of India depends on how much our country is able to recognize its human rights of its citizens. And in this study was done particularly with India. So now, friends, we have to decide whether do we want progress, whether we want economic development which India is planning to do with a lot of competing countries, or do we want to go back 150 years and during the colonized time of India and suffer at the hands of these people. It's all into our hands, friends. You have to decide. Thank you for listening to me.